Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. I thank the Lord. I thank the Lord. There's so many things. You know, sometimes we put numbers on it, it looks like these numbers. For everything, one said many. So everything. There is nothing in my life that is not worth giving God thanks for. There's nothing. Nothing at all. I thank you, Brother Stewie, Apostle Stewie, aka Jesus, for your introduction. And I thank the family for your prayers. Thank you for your commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for remaining steadfast. Though there are many things that might have distracted you, but you have pressed through to this point in your experience. And I pray that you will keep on pressing. Don't ever stop pressing, or keep on pressing. Keep on pressing. There's a song that I have been looking at. The song says, what do you do when you've done all you can and it seems like it's never enough? And what do you say when your friends turn away and you're all alone, all alone? Tell me, what do you give when you've given your all and it seems like you can't make it through? Well, you just stand when there's nothing left to do. You just stand, watch the Lord see you through. Yes, after you've done all you can, you just stand. Tell me, how do you handle the guilt of your past? Tell me, how do you deal with the shame? And how can you smile while your heart has been broken and filled with pain, tell me, what do you give when you've given your all? It seems like you can't make it through. Child, you just stand when there's nothing left to do. You just stand, watch the Lord see you through. Yes, after you've done all you can. Oh, after you've done all you can. After you've done all you can. After you've done all you can, child. After you've done all you can, you just stand. When there's nothing left to do, you just stand. Watch the Lord see you through. You just stand. Having done all, brothers and sisters, having done all, you just stand. And I use that phrase accurately. Having done all that you can, remembering the scripture that says, it is not by might, nor is it by power. And it says, and I'm putting it a little more accurate, it says, not by your might, neither by your power. Right? That you are able to, when you say, having done all. It's not about your strength and your ability. It's about having obeyed the Lord to this point. And it seems like it's not coming together. It seems like you can't make it through. It seems like it's still falling apart. It seems like not hitting the spot. After you've done all you can, stand. Standing right there to me again is not about your posture physically. It has to do with what the Lord has been telling us right here in AWC. And for those of you who have joined us live on YouTube and on Zoom, What the Lord has been telling us over and over again. Establish your dependency on the Lord Jesus Christ. And anticipate His supernatural intervention. And that is what I see as standing. We talk about re-establishing your dependency on the Lord Jesus Christ. And you are re-anticipating His supernatural. It still boils down to say, it's not based on my ability. It's not based on my ability to fix anything. It's not based on my ability to give clarity to anything. It's not based on my ability to provide anything. It is based on me standing on the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. After you have done all, you can stand. After you have done everything that you could possibly imagine to do in the situation, stand. Amen. And wait. As Moses, when Moses was by the Red Sea, and the Lord said what He said to him. We watched TV. I remember watching TV with my mother many years ago. And when the show bring the point where the baby was pregnant, and then shortly after that, she started having baby. And then a few seconds after that, the baby started bawling and grow. But I said, liar, don't never stop. You can't pass. I'm more available to watch you, greetings. Okay? Yeah, because it's moving. So now, we're looking on and hearing the account of Moses standing at the Red Sea. And to us, it seemed as if, as in get the rod and God's appointed and it was stretching, all of a sudden, the sea opened up. You never could tell. You never could tell. You don't know the time period it took for even the winds to start blowing before any movement of water seemed to happen. We don't know the time period. So you can only imagine Moses standing there with the rod in his hand and hearing the Lord say to him, stretch it. And he stretched that rod. And he's anticipating. He's not expecting. And I love walking this prison, we're speaking the higher level term, you know. We're not expecting. We're anticipating. We believe the Lord that He's going to come through. And so we know that something is going to happen. He doesn't know if He's going to just create an iceberg in the middle of the sea for us to walk on. We don't know if He's going to whoop. We don't know, but we're anticipating. We're looking to see the manifestation of that which He's going to do. And it took, maybe it took Him an hour. Maybe it took Him a couple of minutes. We don't know. But that point of Moses standing on the word of the Lord Jesus Christ, on the word, and stretching the rod. And so my brothers and sisters, I want to encourage us. Haven't done everything that you think you could have done. And remember, it's not just about what the physical craves for. It has to do, you see, the scripture did say that they that hunger and thirst after righteousness. And so that is what you're seeking to satisfy, that hunger. You're seeking to satisfy that thirst. And so you are establishing and you're looking into and you're praying. You know, you may pray, you might fast, you're doing all these things because of that hunger and thirst after righteousness. And it seems like it's not yet being satisfied. I'm saying, stand. Keep on pressing, keep on anticipating, keep on looking to see the Lord come through, because as long as He promised it, it's gonna happen. As long as He promised it, it's gonna happen. You might be as Moses, and I know, I think Auntie Sherry was the one who raised the point about the Bible study experience, where you talk about Moses saw the promised land, the ones that are afar off. But based on what the Lord has revealed unto us, not just reading a Bible story and seeing like a movie, but seeing what the Lord is doing, Moses entered the promised land. So it might seem as if, and talk about in Hebrews about them who never lived into the experience that they were promised, but they held it. And so by faith, in faith, they experienced that which the Lord promised them. And so even so, my brothers and sisters, let us not be caught up just in a fleshly experience. Because then you might live in disappointments. Because if you do that, you're living in expectations. And based on what we have learned here, expectations will lead to disappointments. So don't stand on expectations, but stand on an anticipation of that which is to come. Because He's never failed, and He will never fail. And that which He promises, He will bring it to pass. And I just want to encourage us to stand. And look on that word standing. What is that word? What does the word stand really mean when you see it, when you hear it, when you think of it? I'm encouraging my brothers and sisters, don't see it just as a posture to stand. But see it, not just, don't see it physical, but see it beyond the physical. Because He said, you are anticipating. And I want you to see that stand as an anticipation. Not an expectation, but an anticipation that which the Lord has promised, He will bring it to pass. I am just here to share some of the thoughts that the Lord has burnt on my heart. Different things that we will look on. And most importantly, I want to look back on the sermon of the Lord, even last week and the week before and going on back. There was a time when Sir Watson introduced a message back in the days, a talk about beyond the Bible. And I know that I was a very young Christian during that time. And so when I heard it, I embraced it and I was seeing what I was seeing. But then I heard some voices talking about don't add to, talk about Revelation, right? Talk about adding to Bible and things like that. But I recognize that the Lord has called us. The scripture did say that the things that are written in the Bible are for our example. They're for our example. And when I heard Sir mention beyond the Bible, and even now looking on it, I recognize that the Lord has the song, talk about new song. Bible still be written. Bible is still being written. Yes. Yes. When you hear the apostle spoke about Stewart chapter 1, 2, and 3 last week, for example, that is Bible.
Yes. Yes.
That is for our example.
Yes?
And it opens my eyes to recognize that it's not about just, in quotation marks, the good things that we go through. Amen. Because look at the scripture. Murders. Rape. Prostitution. You know, various things happened. And it's Bible, right?
Yeah.
Yeah? And that is for example, no? No, I'm going to answer it. Am I believing the Bible? No. As one man said, I am reinforcing the Bible. And what the essence of the Bible is all about. And that is why, again, I stand confident when the Lord burned in my heart and said, do not live in regret. The experiences that you have had were good for you. Don't live in regret. Something, how can you deal with the past and the shame of the past? Yeah? How can you deal with it? You can't deal with that. You have to recognize that the Lord caused you. Something like gone. Not something gone. The Lord has caused you to go through that particular experience because He's taking you somewhere.
Amen.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me.
Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. The valley, I remember last week, let me walk again on last week. We're talking about many of us tend to get very eerie when you come to the valley. Remember Finding Nemo? Remember Finding Nemo? When Dory said, don't go through there, let's go over, because there's nowhere to go through. Now, let's imagine that eerie place, that valley. And then when they went through it, everything seems to be okay. When they reached a particular point, they saw something that was treacherous and dangerous, right? So the valley of the shadow of death. Now remember, as we said, it's a distraction. The shadow is really a distraction. So the experiences that you are having that are deemed to be valley experiences are distractions. Why? Because it's not the valley you're going to. Amen. So if you allow the shadows to distract you, you will make it to your destination. Yeah. Now remember, the experiences are not necessarily nice while you're going through it. Let's talk about the valley for the time, right? Not necessarily nice while you're going through it. You would wish you wouldn't have it because it doesn't feel good. Don't feel good. It doesn't cause your emotional state to be satisfied and comfortable. So the valley, those things are there and they're coming there to distract you. Now, how you handle, some say handle, right? How you handle those distractions will determine if you make it through the valley or not. That will determine if you make it through the valley or not. And so don't spend time moping while you're going through a valley experience. Because the essence of going through there is for you to do what? To focus.
Yes.
And this time I can say, focus on Jesus.
Amen.
Focus on your source while you're in the valley. Yeah. Don't focus on your ability. Because remember, as we said, it's not by my might. It's not by my ability. Because if I depend on my might and my ability, I know I will not make it. I know I will not make it. And so, go through the valley. Go through with thanksgiving. Go through with joy. Why? Because as Pam talks about, that joy, right?
Yeah.
That is what you should keep as you go through those experiences. Keep that as a hallmark, as a focus, as a focal point, as you journey through these experiences. Brothers and sisters,
hallelujah.
Talk about the practicality of my spirituality. And that is something that I would always express when I talk to people. We will speak the wonderful songs and say the wonderful words, but the Lord God is calling us to be practically expressing that which He's depositing in our being. It's not just for entertainment and say, amen, brother, and so we're in the play, but to practically live it.
Amen.
He calls me now to take to another conversation. Let's keep to talk about wait until he be endued with
power.
The question is, all right, let's just look at the story. When the disciples waited, and they waited, and then the scripture spoke about the cloven tongues and the demonstration of them speaking in tongues, in other tongues, to the point where the glorious miraculous took place, where persons from different nations, different tongues, heard the disciples speaking into their native tongue, the disciples' native tongue, their tongue. And they said, but these men, I talk about them being maybe them drunk and whatever it is, because how could these men be qualified? Can you imagine in growing up, get a community in a school, for example? You're not exposed to Latin and Greek and all those wonderful things. And then all of a sudden, he must speak Latin and Greek. My miraculous took place. And so many persons tend to rest on the power being speaking in another language. But I believe, my brothers and sisters, that that's not the power.
No.
That, am I belittling speaking in tongues? No. That is not the power. Because Paul again said in the scriptures, from this one being, from God Almighty, he has given gifts. And some, are you reading? It's all the various. But what's the purpose of the gift? What's the purpose of the gift? I was sharing with a friend of mine recently, and she was looking at the whole gift of discerning. And we said, it's nice to have it, but it depends on what you're doing it. Because there are many persons who have that gift of discerning, as she said, and just want to come tell us later on. And tell us it. I'm saying that's one side of the story. There are others who will have the gift, and nobody will be like them.
Do you know who I am?
I prophesy. I see your future. Since they have become upon themselves. So it's what you do with the gift. But more importantly, that power, I believe, my brothers and sisters, is first impact. Me, Sean Mitchell. If I declare that I have received the power of the Lord Jesus Christ, my life is supposed to be that vehicle that propels that message. My life. And so the question, my brother and sister, is, do you really have the power? Do you really have that power that you proclaim that you have? I want to encourage us that remember that the gift is really for the demonstration of the Lord Jesus Christ's presence in our being. It is to give him the glory.
Amen.
And so if he is not being glorified, then, again, the scripture, people say the Bible contradicts itself, but I see a great network. The scripture also says that, though you, and I hope it don't happen, right? Right, read him again. Julie. Though you might be able to minister in a particular way, the moment you lose focus, God is not taking away that gift from you. The scripture says that the gifts and calling are without repentance. He's not taking it from you. Because Sir Watson again shared with us, and it's in 1 Peter saying, every man is born with a seed. And that seed is that gift that God has given to you. Point to note, brothers and sisters, don't be the greedy dog. Don't be that greedy dog. You know that greedy dog story?
Yeah?
Don't look over the fence and say, how comes? And then the servant who will get one, and I compare his one to him who get 5 and 20. Don't be the greedy dog. Can the eye say, because I am not the head, I am not the eye, I am not of the body? Can the fingernail say, because I am not the heart, I am not of the body? No. So don't be envious of that which seem to be a greater gift than yours. The key is to that seed that you have been blessed with, to nurture it, to look after it, so that it may become that which the Lord has purposed to be manifested in your life. Your seed fulfilling its purpose will indeed show forth the beauty of the entire body, because the fingernail don't do its purpose, you know. The body will feel it. If the eye don't do its purpose, the body will feel it. If the pores, if the body don't do its purpose, the body will feel it. So you need to use and employ, I'm using the word employ, because employ sounds like a bigger diamond, right? But it's the same meaning themselves. You need to employ that which the Lord has blessed you with to accomplish that glorifying of him.
Amen.
And that's the key. We need to do that. I was talking about the valley, but the Lord showed me again last week, according to Stewie chapter so and so and so. You see that mountaintop experience? It's another thing, you know. I know we all love to talk about the mountaintop. Oh my God. That's the place everybody wants to be. Nobody wants to go to the valley. But everybody wants to be on the mountaintop. Because the mountaintop seems to be, you know, you're above it all, and you're superior, and as my brother says, be superior to fear, right? There. But he pulled a scripture, and I was reminded of it also. When the disciples went up on the mountain of transfiguration. Let me read that scripture, right? Yeah. There are mount, and when you think about mount, I don't know if Jerusalem mount looked like Blue Mountain, right? But I'm reliable source and no comparison. But let's just imagine it was such a high mountain like Blue Mountain, looking over and seeing all the St. Andrew plains and all of that, right? And they went up there, and the Lord showed them some beautiful things. Oh my God! Like many of us, when you're anointing upon you, I don't want to leave. I want to stay here, God. I want to stay right here. It feels nice. It feels good. I feel empowered. I don't want to come down from here. It's the mountain, right? Yes. But the Lord said, the disciples said, Lord, Father, Jesus, Master, we could build some tabernacle.
Yeah.
I see, yes, sir. Yes, so nice. You know? yes, sir, nice. No one come down. God, I'm stepping in. I said, what are you? What are you doing? This is not what I called me here for. Eh? No. Brothers and sisters, right there and there. That was distraction.
Yeah.
That was, you don't recognize what I want. They were distracted by that which they saw. And nothing wrong with them, see. Nothing wrong with what they saw, you know. They saw Jesus transfigured before their eyes, became bright, and they saw Moses, they saw Elias, they saw Elijah, they saw, and marvelous thing. Nothing wrong with it. It was awesomely God that they saw. But they were distracted.
Yes.
They were distracted by that which they saw. To the point where they weren't able to recognize the purpose of being there. And I want you to compare that mountaintop experience to the valley experience. It's not about what you're going through. It's not about what you're experiencing. It's not about you being on a mountaintop or in a valley. It's not about that. It's about you being focused. You're being purpose focused while you're going through your varied experience. Why am I here? And I remember the servant of the Lord said, that seed that the Lord blessed you with is for God's glory. It's not about you being seen as a great orator or an awesome singer or a great this or a great that. The Lord might give you that as a ministry. But what are you doing with it? Is it to heap upon yourself to be this great and mighty one? And then you end up like the Israelites. Deuteronomy chapter 8, right? Yeah. Eh?
Yes.
Deuteronomy chapter 8. Yeah. They're conquering. They're mighty. To the point where my little country named AI mashed them up. Yeah. You remember that story, right?
Yes,
you remember that story, right?
Yes,
because they went, somebody said, just two little nations on this, man. You send half of the people over there, just mash them up. Because of our experiences, we are known to. You understand? They didn't wait to see. Lord, should I go? So the glory wasn't for the Lord when they were doing that.
Yes, yes.
The glory was to show for their might
and
their power. But then the Lord had to step in again. I said, because it's me, have that, bring you through that experience. I'm wanting to recognize it. It is me who will take you further. Amen. So because you've gone off in your own might, in your own power, they say, don't. And so, the little country chased them, run, come back home, and then start bawling the whole comes. And we know the story of Achan that came out of that, etc., right? But I want to encourage my brothers and sisters that we have to remember who we are, where we're going. Now, with that seed also, the servant of the Lord said that we are also given a lane to run in. And Everybody know the road in Jamaica is as such. And people say drivers in Jamaica are the worst. I don't know. You know about Jamaica, right? Maybe you go England and Europe, you might see them as well. But and I was thinking, about it, I said, we ascribe it as taxi drivers. You know, the robot taxi drivers, you know? But never say, it's the robot taxi drivers, but that mentality. All them drive on the road is nasty. And so, you are in your lane. Pitches. You're in your lane. And you're doing that which you are to do. Because the lane, you're fulfilling your purpose, you're doing your thing. Then all of a sudden, somebody bad driver up here. What do you do? What do you do? And I'm going to say, do not be distracted by the voices in the night. Remember that Sunday? Yes. We're building with the left hand, and we're battling with the right. Keep on doing a good work for the kingdom of God. Doing a good work, we're going to stand our ground. Revival is outpouring for rebuilding and restoring. We're doing the work for Jesus, and we won't come. We won't come down. In other words, it seems as if somebody disturbing you in the course of your fulfilling your purpose in your lane. Don't drop it and run. Don't drop it and run. Again, that's a distraction. These things are happening to distract you from fulfilling your purpose. But it comes down to what is that drive in your heart? What is that drive in your heart? What is that thing that, what is it? What are you being pulled towards? Paul says, I press towards the mark of the prize of the high calling of God. So I'm pressing towards what I see as my purpose in Christ. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, many times we ask for certain things. When we get it, we get distracted.
True.
When I miss it away enough. Elisha not working, new scenario. Elisha get tired of staying home. Elisha don't even appreciate staying home fully enough. Just get tired of staying home. And I'm using that as a typical example. I watched a movie last time, some nights ago, and this girl was talking about Holland, where the lady took a trip to go to Holland. No, to Italy, sorry, to Italy. But somehow the ship docked in Holland. And the point is that the lady in Holland recognized that she really wanted to go to Italy. But before she make up and get distressed, she decided to appreciate what Holland had to offer. And then, if Italy can come, Italy will come.
Yes.
The thing is that many times we don't get to appreciate our present situation.
Yes.
If we want to jump out of it. Many times. Many times God is taking us through, you want to call the valley? To the valley, for us to be able to have a new perspective,
yes.
To appreciate something different, even more about him or about yourself, whatever it is. But we don't even pay attention to this. We want to quickly go to where we think we want it to go. And so, go back to Ellie. Ellie, not working. Ellie at home, and all Ellie's mind is on, well, I'm going to work, I'm going to work. Work, get it out, on work, work, work. God give our work. Oh, God get work. The worst work she ever did. So that even that you can't appreciate, doesn't it? Is that what I show you? So I'm saying, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, we are called to these various experiences. So that we can appreciate the Lord God more than what we have now. If you don't appreciate the experience you're going through, it reminds me again of what we're talking about this morning, in our men's conversation. We call them mistakes. Call them mistakes. The things that we didn't purpose for it to go a particular way, but it happened and it seemed to be wrong. So we call it a mistake. And my brother said, if we purpose for it to go that way, was it a mistake? Right? Was it a mistake? But it was a mistake. Have we learned from that mistake? It was a misstep. Did we learn from that misstep? And if we have learned from that misstep, it means that our next step should be different. Yes? The key is for us to learn. The key is for us to appreciate, what is it that God will have me to do in this situation? You're in a job that you might feel, or in a course, and you're going to say, this course looks wrong. But you're in it. You have a flunky that says, do something else. No. What is it this for me, Lord? I'm a kingdom citizen. I'm not here by chance. But no, so it's not Holland really wants to go, it's Italy. But God, you caused the ship to stop and dock and broke down, whatever. I can't reach Italy. I am here in Holland. Why am I here, Lord? What's my purpose? I have a seed in my being. I'm a purpose-driven individual. You have called me by your name. You have placed your Holy Spirit inside of me. Why am I here? That's supposed to be our first response. Yeah. But too often, we default to feeling. Talking about feelings. I don't know that sound. That sound goes. Right? We default to that fleshly state. So some people get bored and just drop through and then later on live in regret. I'm encouraging us. Let's live above that. Let's live above that. Let's live above that. Let me say, I'm just sharing a few thoughts that I have. I'm not going to stay much longer. I'm not going to stay much longer. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, I did mention, I think it's 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and we're looking at the bread. And a few thoughts I have in my heart. And I remember when the Lord burned in my heart, and I talk about Revelation. He said, the Lord, Stewart chapter, emphasize the point. And Richard chapter, emphasize the point. The Serving chapter, emphasize the point. The Lord is causing us to write, I can't say our own Bible, to write Bible. Yeah. You want to add to? We don't really add to per se, we're writing. We keep writing. Why? Because we are experiencing the Lord in new ways. New ways. And these experiences we are able to share with our children or our children's children. We don't have to quote Genesis chapter 1. We can say, I had this experience with the Lord. Because we go to Genesis chapter 1, that experience Moses had with the Lord. And Moses, when we say Moses, we're referring to Moses' experience with the Lord. Nothing wrong with that. But we should be able to be in a position to say, Gabriel, this happened to me with the Lord, so on, so on, so on. So, when you talk about testimony, that's the writing of the Bible. You're giving glory, you're saying, this is the Lord. You're not about all about being hunky dory and all right. What's about that which the Lord will work in our being to fulfill, to glorify His name. His name. And that is the reason why we are here, brothers and sisters. To glorify the Lord God. Glorify His name. And so, I love this family of God. I love this family of God. Paul said, I think it's Paul who said it. Is all of Israel Israel? Is all of Israel Israel? Right? Is all of Israel Israel? That doesn't stop me from saying, I love this family of God. It doesn't stop me from saying that. Because I have a hope. Thank God for it. I have a hope. I have a desire. And I'm praying through. And I'm saying, Lord, let thy kingdom come. Hallelujah. Lord, let thy will be done in us as it is in heaven. And so we're not speaking a lot to say in the earth. Hallelujah. We're saying in us. When I'm by myself, the Lord, in me as it is in heaven. Yes? That is the desire that I have. That is the desire I want us to have, my brother and sister. So, wherever you find yourself in any situation, let your focus be on the Lord Jesus Christ. Let your desire be for the Lord Jesus Christ to be glorified. And if your actions are inactions, you recognize that it's not glorifying the Lord, I say, repent. You have to see the one, be the one to recognize that it's not going right. And then you repent. I remember saying this a couple of times, and I would always say to myself, and there's no excuse to keep on doing the ungodly other things. You cannot change people. Yeah? Samantha Amoy Mitchell is my daughter. And I was sharing with my brother this morning. She has stepped over the threshold of child. I must now manage the situation so as not to impose on her adulthood. Bear in mind that she's still living under a roof, right? In the context of the situation, right? And so the Lord created and gave us the exposure for us to manage situations. But remember, we can't change people. Mothers and fathers, we are called upon to create the environment that our children will be brought up in righteousness, so that they'll be able to choose righteously when the time comes, even before they move out, while they are growing up, choose righteously. So when death goes to Ulmas and an exposure come up, death has such as an upbringing, you want to call it, that where she's able to choose if she go there, she do that, she don't that, because of the home that she was nurtured in. So when she gets older and she's no longer in that home, but she has her own home, that foundation that she has will equip her to again even choose righteously as she move on. And thus the whole point is that we cannot change people. You could have beat the boy till him black and blue. If him set, this is not going to do. Not going to do it. So what do we do? Song again. When you've done all you can, and it seems as if the boy had turned to the worst. It seems as if the girl now got nothing. It seems as if it's not working out. What do you do? I say, stand. 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 And remember, that stand up is a stand up on your foot and say, no, this is the point of my house. You know, another thing come to mind. The scripture talk about contend for the faith. Remember hearing that scripture, right?
Yes,
sir. Contend for the faith. The first time I hear a man address it, me hear God start draw and sword start swing. I'm going to fight for the faith. I'm going to defend the faith. It's like the jihad, holy war. You really fight. I'm going to defend the faith. You know, I said, Jesus. You know, I said, that's not what contend. Because remember, who you are is where the contending starts. You are the representative of what you are defending. When I see you, I see Christ. When I see you, I see the faith that you declare that you have. My brother said, work faith. And it's a manifestation. How you live, how you talk, how you seal. I remember when I just became a Christian, the phrase I heard, the first Jesus anybody will see is you. You. The first Jesus anybody will see. So be that example. Be that reflection, be that mirror, be that anything you want to call it. Let them see Christ in you, the hope of glory. Song says, I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And
And just the time I need him, he's always there. He lives, he lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and he talks with me along that narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart.
Lord bless you. As you establish and re-establish your dependency on him and watch him come through in ways that you could never imagine. Take care.